Okay, so we discussed briefly about iron ore beneficiation. Now there, so not many mining engineers are here. You see that in our entire effort, we are trying to develop a flow sheet for our iron ore slimes. But I have not seen any research group, at least in India, they are working on how I am going to mine my tailing ponds. Say tailing ponds, they are basically there for last 40 years. So even the challenge is that how do I sample it? What is the average grade of my iron ore and in terms of alumina and silica? How do I sample it? Because it is almost like a quicksand. So how do I approach it? What will be the mining technologies? Because they are all ultra fines. You don't need ventilation, you don't need blasting, but how, what will be the mining technology for that? So that research is not being taken up by our mining people. That is on record, I am saying. I think that parallelly we should also take over that part. Because even though we develop a process for iron ore beneficiation and then pelletization, but if we don't know how to mine it from my tailing pond, then again we have to wait. So that is also an important one. Now this talk, I will go for, basically emphasize more on fundamentals of pelletization process. Okay, what is the pelletization process and how do I, what are the basically fundamental issues here? So if you look at the common pelletization flow sheet, it has got three broad areas. One is basically where you are basically grinding the, again the slimes, that is minus 150 micron has to be ground to below 63 micron. So there I need a closed circuit grinding operation. Then your cyclone and this say configuration is there. Then there is a, in pelletization there are two sections. One is basically you call it green ball. Green ball means is basically when you make the pellet, but there I have got moisture and all this. So it does not have sufficient strength. So to make it more stronger, again I have to hit it, and when you are hitting it, the water will go out, and then you need one kind of again that incipient fusion between the particles, that is in the sintering process what we did with the much more coarser particles. So that is basically the hitting one. So that is called the indurating machines, that is where basically we are calling it firing session. So this is the grinding section, this is the balling section, that is where we make the pellets, basically the green pellets, where we have got, it does not have sufficient strength, and that for strength purposes we are firing them. Okay. So we will discuss a bit on some more on this part than these two part here. So pelletizing of iron ore, if you look at, it is not a very new technology. It was started in 1950s to facilitate the utilization of finely ground iron ore concentrates in steel production. Two main types of processes have been developed, that is the straight grate and the grate kiln processes. These are mainly for the firing purposes, not for the boiling purposes or not for the grinding purposes. In the straight grate process, a stationary bed of pellets is transported on an endless traveling grate through the drying, oxidation, sintering and cooling zones. That means how you will heat it up then and how do I cool them. Any metallurgy people, they know that the heating cycle is basically controls your the structure, internal microstructure of my any material, what do we try to basically the convert into metal into product. So here also, if I heat them quickly, then the water will go out immediately and I will have a fragmented particle again. So that has to be a proper control of that your heating and cooling cycle. Okay. So the grate kiln process, drying and most of the oxidation is accomplished in a stationary pellet bed. That is basically more of a design issues. That is, how do I heat them, how do I basically cool them. The initial agglomerates are called green pellets, and until they are sintered in the kiln and become pellets, that is your firing. Okay. Now a narrow size distribution in green pellets is an important criteria for the pellet quality, because as we said, as we discussed, that if I have very close size range of these particles, I can have more permeability in the bed, and if I have that spherical shape. Okay. So that is what I have written. Then in practice, variations occur in the properties of the incoming pellet feed, like moisture content, fineness and wettability. That is also very important, that is whether my surfaces are, how much of that weighting is there. So, that is basically a surface related phenomena also. So, that is basically controlled by your contact angles, okay. What is the contact angle between those particle and my your water, which result in fluctuations in the green pellet growth rate and size distribution. That means the kinetics of pellet formation, that is your layering mechanism at each layer, how they are formed, how we are controlling that, that basically controls the green pellet strength and all this and subsequent stages. Disturbances in boiling give rise to increasing recycling loads. That means the how much of that fines per unit time I am converting them into pellets. Otherwise, what will happen? I have to give more time for that your pellets to be formed in the green pelletizers, okay. So, that is again a kinetics control. So, that is basically a capacity and all these related issues are there. Excessive surging causes problems not only in the boiling circuit but also in the induration machines, because if I have got more ultra fines which are not converted into your pellets, then in sintering machines also, that is in your firing one, it will create problems, okay. Disturbances in the pellet size distribution are regulated either mechanically by adjusting the screen openings for the recycling load or for the on size fraction, or chemically by varying the moisture content or the binder doses. Now, how do I control the size? How do I know what size they are? So, it has to be negotiated into a screen surfaces, okay. That is what is the size range. And then how do I control them? Say suppose they are not getting converted, so I need more of moisture or maybe more of binding agents. Because how do I bind them together? Because there I am not using the heating, so it is a physical process, okay. So, what is the role of the binder, what is the role of the moisture, I must first understand to understand the pelletization process fundamental point of view. Increasing the binder doses is known to decrease the green pellet growth rate, making the pellet smaller, while increasing the water content results in an opposite effect. What happens if I am using more pellet, more binder? So, immediately I will have small, small nodules. So, I cannot control the size, that is what I want, because they are already getting you. But if I use more of water, what will happen? So, that is a critical amount of water you need, where what is basically the optimum one. Above that, what will happen? Again, the particle will start getting dispersed. So, again, I will not be having. So, that is called the flooding occurs, okay. So, these are basically and how much I need of that binder, that is in the form of your water, or maybe water is also a binder here, or some other materials which I will discuss what they are. So, that is determined, that is dependent on my material surface characteristics. So, because of that I must understand that what is the mechanism of these ball formations, okay. Why do I need them, how do they do it, what are the different routes of different mechanisms for doing that. Now, if I look at the green pellet properties, basically the different mechanisms, only with water I am describing it first, that is green pellet compression strength, okay. That is very, very important, because if I do not have the strength, when I am feeding it from the blast furnace at that height, it will be broken. So, I need to have sufficient strength even at the green boiling stages, okay. Because when I am heating it, the water will go out of the system. So, it is basically controlling that. So, in wet agglomerates, the liquid, that is the water, acts as a binder. Wet agglomerates can exist in a number of different states depending on the amount of the binder liquid present. So, in one way, they may be binding my material in this form, that is called the pendular structure. That is basically you are binding different particles of my iron ore, okay. This is a funicular structure. You see that there is a difference between these two structures, like some of these they are basically all encapsulated with water. Here there are basically open zones here. So, here I am using less water, here I am using little bit more water, okay. And then the capillary one, it is all basically linked with all this water, no vacant space is there, that is the capillary action. Then I can have droplet, I can have pseudo droplets like this. So, at low saturations, the particles are held together by liquid bridges, that is your pendular bonds or pendular state. So, when you add little bit moisture, it starts forming, the bonds starts basically forming because of this pendular structure, okay. You add little bit more moisture in the funicular state, basically the we just get converted into pendular to funicular stage, both liquid filled capillaries and liquid bridges coexist. Then in the capillary state, all capillaries are filled with water, that is in this state, all capillaries, there is no cavity now, all filled with basically water, and concave surfaces are formed in the pore openings due to the capillary forces. Okay. The droplet state occurs when the agglomerate is kept together by the cohesive force of the liquid, and in the pseudo droplet state, unfilled voids remain trapped inside the droplet. These are the different states when you are adding water. Okay. Now, liquid filling degree, now how do I know how much of is the say degree of liquid filling into my structure. So, liquid filling degree or liquid saturation describes the portion of the pore volume which is filled with the binder liquid and is calculated from this equation, where S is equal to liquid filling degree, F is equal to moisture contained by wet weight, that is how much of moisture I have added. This epsilon is fractional porosity. What is the fractional porosity of that? Basically the structure. And then rho p and rho l are the density for particles and water respectively. Now, the capillary theory for wet agglomerate strength is well established and described in textbooks dealing with agglomeration of iron ore. So, we can take these references. If you want more detailed knowledge about this capillary theory, you can get into that. But because of the paucity of the time, I had to restrict it up to this for this lecture. The summary of the capillary theory, if you summarize from this textbooks, you will find that is your the particle systems with a freely movable binder like water, that it explains the agglomerate wet strength in terms of the liquid filling degree as shown schematically. That is your schematically, if you look at that is filling degree of voids with water, areas of main bonding forces for green pellet. That is, if I have 0.2% of this void, that is a 20%, that is in fraction I am saying, 20% of the void is basically filled with water, then my tensile strength basically goes up, and as you keep on increasing there, there is a critical limit where you get the maximum tensile strength. I am not talking about compressive strength, I am talking about tensile strength. Okay. So, the tensile strength reaches a maximum value here, and more addition of filling, it drops because the flooding occurs. Then basically it becomes only all flooded. The particle and fluid, they will be like your suspension or maybe settling will start occurring, and then they will start flowing. So, you are not getting that bonds. So, that you have to control, and this depends on the surface morphology and other properties of my iron ore fines. So, that I must know before I do the pelletization process, select the right pelletizing conditions. Okay. According to the capillary theory, the agglomerate wet strength reaches a maximum at the capillary state. This takes place at around 90% liquid filling degree. That means, how much of void is it there? If they are 90% filled, then I can get this basically the maximum strength. Okay. But they have to be filled up in a homogeneous manner. The agglomerate strength at this point is given by the so called rump equation, that what will be the strength of that. So, the sigma c, that is your green pellet weight tensile strength due to capillary forces, is equal to A, that is a constant that you have to select, that you have to determine for your material by doing some test. Epsilon is the fractional porosity, then your gamma is basically liquid surface tension, I must know that, d is equal to average particle size, and theta ls, it is basically the contact angle. So, I have to measure the contact angle and all these properties, and I have to do some tests to get the constant value to understand that how much of strength is achievable for this material using water, and that water quality also basically determines what type of water. Is it a recycled water from my plant, or is it a water from some other sources? So, what is the pH of that? How much of dissolved solid content into that? How much of suspended solids are there? So, these are very, very critical issues for this mechanism. The equation, what this equation tells me, that the tensile strength of a wet agglomerate increases with decreasing porosity and particle size. So, that means why? Decreasing porosity means, that means I have added more binder. Okay. Particle size means, decreasing particle size means I am having more surface area. So, that means more contact area between my binders and my particles. Okay. And the mass of this individual particle is less, so that my your forces to held them together requirement is less. So that's why I have to grind my iron ore again for these slimes to be converted into pellets. Okay. With increasing surface tension, complete weighting is necessary for fully developed capillary forces. So your contact angle is also very important. And now if I know this, that what are the contact angles, what are the properties of that, now you can add some chemicals also to modify some of them. That is again another research domain, that is how I can improve my contact angle. That is, with my water, can I add some chemical to improve the contact angle? Can I increase the surface tension forces related to that? So these are basically again the research domain where you can work on. Okay. The capillary forces are much stronger than the pendular bonds. If you remember, that is the structures. The agglomerate strength with fully developed liquid bridge at S is equal to 30% is only about 1/3 of the maximum strength. Okay. In the funicular state, where binding takes place by both the pendular bonds and the capillary forces, the agglomerate strength can be estimated from the relative amount of filled capillaries. That is, again you can substitute in this equation and you have to know that how much of that is filled up. So how do I know how much, what is the degree of filling? Degree of filling I can go by the weight gain method, that is how much of water has gone into the system. And if I want to know the detail that how they are distributed, I can have some kind of your microscopic techniques to look at, that is high resolution microscopes I have to use it to see that whether it is getting dispersed and whether my degree of filling is homogeneously filled, or maybe if it is selectively filling some of the say cavities and some of the cavities are unfilled, then again I cannot control the size of my pellets. Okay. So at S is equal to 100%, flooding takes place and the agglomerate deforms under its own weight. That is what. So you cannot have your say moisture, or you cannot add water of your waste, you know, there has to be an optimum for that. The Rump equation also describes, strictly speaking, the tensile strength of agglomerates. The measurement of tensile strength is, however, very time consuming and cannot be applied to large number of pellets in a similar manner as is applicable in the compression strength measurement. So measuring of tensile strength is also very difficult. Tensile strength is like you are pulling them and then you are trying to see. But compressive strength is very easy, because you put a pressure and you see that how much of pressure it can withstand and that at what pressure it breaks and all. So the compression strength is always larger than the tensile strength, because the compression force needs to overcome the friction between particles. Okay. So that is what, the for the measurement point of view. So I can have some kind of your relationship based on my material and based on my design of setup, that what is the relationship of my compressive strength and the tensile strength for this material, and then I can have some kind of your calibration type of chart, so that I can quickly get into that what will be my compression strength, and then if this is my compression strength, what will be the tensile strength, and then I can use Rump model and all this, okay, to get into that. Now what is the role of this binder? Other than water, why do I need to add some other foreign materials as a binder? Okay. As mentioned earlier, the capillary theory was developed for particle systems with freely movable binders like water, and viscosity effects are not included in this model. Not only viscosity, I said the different other issues, like what is the purity of that water. I cannot use distilled water, that may be the best for this, but the cost of distillation process. So what will be the water quality, that is also a research process, okay, research method. So today viscous binders are used in iron ore pelletization. We need viscous binder, because what will happen, then the viscosity will try to hold them together, it is not freely movable. So I do not want them to be freely movable, so that they are held together. So the viscous binders are basically, a large variety of binders have been tested and reported in literature. Very common is basically the bentonite, that is the most common binder is the bentonite clay, that is abundantly available. But what type of bentonite, what is their basically morphology, what is the basically chemical compositions? Bentonite clay also can be of various types. So not all the bentonites you can use it, you have to control that. Many times you may have to beneficiate even that bentonite also, that is the clay processing domain. Okay. So even for using them, I may need to beneficiate that that your bentonite also, because that is also a naturally occurring basically material. The amount of bentonite added is typically between 0.5 to 0.7%. Now, if I add more bentonite, what will happen? The particle will be, the bond will be so strong that again the, because of the compactness of this, again my reducibility will be reduced. So, my kinetics will hamper. So, I need that critical strength, what the optimum strength, what the metallurgists have specified based on their test, like your Satter test, Tumbler test and all the Mikan test and all this. Okay. So, I cannot just arbitrarily add, and if I have less binder, then my strength may be so weak that it could be friable again. So, bentonite also, the problem with bentonite is that it swells when mixed with water and increases the viscosity of the water phase. So, I must know the swelling index of my pellets, because when you heat it up, what is the volume expansion of that? Okay. That also I need to know, and after swelling, what is the strength? That is also very important. So, the influence of bentonite binder on the green pellet on compressive strength and dry compressive strength is shown in the following. That is, your, if I have hematite, if it is only dry pellets, the strength is up to this region. Okay. And for your dry pellets, that is after firing, it shoots up. That is the role of the firing section. That is, you need to fire them, otherwise this strength is not enough. For magnetite, this is the correlation for your dry pellets and the green pellets using a, your bentonite of that 0.5 to 0.7%. Then another very fundamental issue with the pellet, green pellet, is the plasticity. That is, whether it is elastic or plastic and how much, what degree of plasticity is basically allowable. So, iron ore green pellets show both plastic and elastic behavior. Plastic deformation occurs, for example, due to the load of above lying green pellets in a static bed of green pellets on a conveyor belt or on the grate. Because what happens, I am not talking about one or two pellets, I am talking about again a large tonnages of material to be handled. Now, you have seen in the first slide that I have to transfer my green pellets into my firing zone. So, how do I transport them? So, mostly we transport them by your belt conveyors. So, belt conveyors, if it is only single layer, then my productivity per unit area is also less. So, I have to have multi layers. So, when I have a multi layers, so you are having pressure gradient also. So, these green pellets have to withstand that load, otherwise if it breaks in that process, then my entire purpose is defeated. So, when you are transferring to your firing zone, there are also some material handling, some stresses are there. So, it has to withstand that strength. So, green pellet strength also up to a some level you need, otherwise before it reaches the your firing zone, it may be broken. Okay. So, the plastic deformation also takes place during rolling and facilitates the green pellet consolidation and growth. That is, how do I make it? Before I discuss this, probably let me show you some of these your pelletizers. Okay. This is a, like your disc pelletizer. That is your green pellet where you make it. What you do? You have got this inclination for your material transport, it rotates, and then you are adding your binders and water here, and then you are slightly basically rotating it, and each rotation layer by layer that pellets are formed, that is green balls are formed. And then when they are formed, they will roll over here and then you are collecting them with a scraper. So, that is how basically you are doing that. But in the process, I should have sufficient strength into that green pellet for my say your downstream processes. This is one of the pelletizers I have shown. Okay. There are others also. So, basically the plastic deformation is strongly dependent on both the amount of moisture and the bentonite content. So, that is what you have to do it. That is the research for pelletization in the green pelletization stage. And as I keep repeating that this is a nature made material. So, you have to characterize your iron ore for this pelletization purposes, that what is the contact angle, what are the basically the surface morphology, the rheology of the your say fluid what you are using, and what will be the optimum your ratio of my bentonite and your water, you know, for that. Elasticity in green pellets is generally believed to be important for green pellet durability during loading from one conveyor belt to another. That is, okay, I have imparted some strength, but how durable they are? Suppose I am firing them after 1 hour, okay. So, is it durable up to that? Because your moisture will start getting evaporated. So, whether it can withstand that rate of evaporation or with the rate of strength I can retain, or how much time it takes, okay. Maybe it takes sometimes your say few minutes, but even that I have to look at that. What is the durability of that? So, it is also expected to be relevant for green pellet resistance during bouncing in the bowling drum. That is, when you are basically rotating, that is your inclined one. So, when they are falling and they may be hitting the surface of that material, or maybe another ball is hitting another ball, that is a pellet. So, there may be a bouncing effect. So, when the bounces, so how much it bounces, and then again it is coming back. So, you are having again impact, whether it can withstand that your basically those forces to retain its shape and its structure, okay. Otherwise, again it will be fragmented. So, that is what my elasticity basically is responsible for that. That is what we call it, the elasticity of the material, okay. The green pellet impact strength is usually described by the drop number, the number of drops from a given height before breakage. That is what we do, it is a very simple test that I have got a surface for which the material properties I know, I have got a particular height, I drop them after one drop, I see that whether it is broken or not, or say suppose I take 5 kg of that material of because sizes and how much of fines I have generated out of that. I measure it and then we see it that how many cycles it can withstand. So that during my material handling, I can just correlate that whether it can withstand that much of your handling, your say resistance and all this, you know. So that we have to know it, that is what is the basically the strength of that. Because if I have sent it to my firing squad, and if they are broken, so I have unnecessarily consumed my energy for that firing and I do not have any pellet coming out of that. So, it is a wastage of energy and then it may choke some of my passages because I have to in a heating chamber also I have to have a gas flow and all this, okay. So, it may choke my passage also there. So, that is also a very important thing. Now, bowlability means at what rate, that is what is the kinetics of that size. Say suppose I want 10 millimeter size from a size of below 63 micron, okay. So, what would be my RPM of my machine? What will be at what rate I will be, say suppose I need, okay, 0.5% to 0.7% of bentonite, but should I add it in one go or should I add it in incremental way? So, at and then how the different layers form, because not at one rotation you will get from below 63 micron to 10 millimeter size. So, each rotation I am having some kind of your layering. So, what is the mechanism of that layering and what is the kinetics of that layer formation, that in terms of that we call it bowlability, and how fast you can get those balls of that sufficient strength, that will determine that what is the capacity of my green pelletizer, and that is where the different designs are coming. That is the only one design I have shown. But what kind of your green pelletizer designs will be there? So, that varies from your material to material depending upon your say control of these RPMs, depending upon the need, you know, and then addition of your water as well as your other binders, how do I add them. So, bowlability is defined as the ability of particulate matter to form pellets. Whether my this iron ore is basically pelletizable, whether I can convert it on, because it is a surface phenomena, may not be. If my surface roughness is, say suppose if I have a very smooth surface for some particle, and if I add and if it is totally hydrophilic, and if I put it into a pelletizer, okay, can you get a pellet? No, because if it is hydrophobic, then it is not basically getting weighted, the surfaces. So, I do not have any funicular structure, I do not have any pendular structure. So, how the bond will be held together? So, I have to look at that, what is the property of that material. Similarly, for iron ores from different deposits may have different bowlability characteristics depending upon the its morphology, its basically surface structures and other properties, okay. depending upon the nature of impurities it has got, or what modifies the surface characteristics of my particle. So, this is also basically a surface characteristic dependent phenomena. The main parameters for good bullability in iron ore pellet feeds are the fineness of the raw material. More the surface area, more the chances of, because the more amount of water can get adhered to the surfaces. So, I can held them together. So, then, but more fineness means more energy to make them more finer. So, I want to use them, but for that I am spending more energy to make them finer and finer, but in the process what will happen, my entire process may not be cost effective. And more finer means during handling, how do I charge it? I am not showing, it is not basically a 1 kilogram of material I am talking about. The bulk material handling systems, when they charge it, deliver it, transportation. So, my losses will be more, my environmental problems will be more. So, these are all the consequences. Okay. The moisture contained in balling, binder doses and good weighting of the particle. This will all control my, basically the at what rate my balls will be formed. The raw material fineness in balling is commonly expressed using the specific surface area, or it is called the Blaine number. So, that is why you have to have some kind of your surface area measurements. I cannot just calculate, that is what in my first lecture I said, that looking at the material you cannot say what is the surface area of that. So, you have to measure it. So, what is the surface area of that? So, there are some tests that like your beat is surface area, and there is another test which is basically a shortcut method to get into that, that is called a Blaine number, Blaine permeability method. The Blaine values are expressed in centimeter square per gram. That means, in if I have 1 gram of this material, how much is the surface area in terms of centimeters. So, normally pellet feeds should have Blaine values between 1500 and 2000 centimeter square per gram, but the exact behavior in balling with coarser raw materials is not well documented because of the complex nature of the balling process. So, here again the research domain is that if I can make pellets at a coarser sizes, having sufficient strength and the properties what do we want, so that is advantageous. So, why I have to grind below 150 micron to below 63 micron? Again, that is consuming a lot of energy. So, can I not have a binder which is cost effective, which is basically environment effective, that means it is not toxic, it is not corrosive and it is abundantly available, which can bind or give me the pellets even at minus 150 micron sizes. That could be a research topic, and if you can do it, you are saving lot of energy. Again, you are basically contributing a lot in the pelletization technique. So, that is what one could be the research topic, that is how coarse is the material. So, what is the again the reagent synthesis, your other analysis, you know, strong background, if you have strong background in chemistry, you can think of a good binder design, synthetic design, okay, of a binder, so that I can bind even at 150 micron sizes. Even if it costs you a bit more, but do the cost benefit analysis of grinding from a minus 150 micron to minus 63 micron, it consumes a huge lot of energy, and then your losses as your as a super fines, you know, environmental problems and all this. So, this is the way why we have to what I was emphasizing, that we must look at the problems, okay. That is, if I can do it retaining the similar properties of my basically the balls. Then each raw material has an optimum moisture content for balling. You cannot say that irrespective of its origin that I need this much of moisture. That is where again you have to do some test work. You have to understand, and what we are trying to do, we are just getting that material, we are doing it into a pelletizer, and then we are saying that okay, you add this much of moisture. But when your ore characteristic changes, it will change. Why do you blame that my ore characteristic changes? This is a nature made thing. We are mining it. So, as you are mining, it is not a selective one, and nobody has guaranteed that your nature made things are basically homogeneous, they are heterogeneous. So, if I am doing research on that, I must tell that if your ore characteristic changes like this, your moisture addition should be this and your water quality should be this. So, why don't you specify that? It should not be a particular deposit specific, let us make generic one, that could be a research. But if I say that I have got this material, 5 kg material, if I see a PhD thesis on that and then I have done this and said this is the microscopic thing, I have done this characterization, I would say that I am not excited with this research. Even though you have put a lot of effort in knowing the characteristic of that, put it a very sophisticated your microscopic techniques to understand that, but I say that that is only valid for that 5 kg material. Are you guaranteeing that 5 kg material characteristic will be similar to other deposits? What will happen if my this property changes? Then you are gone. So that is what we should try to do at least in PhD level. Let us bring some kind of your generic models, generic understanding of this phenomena. Very easy to say but very difficult to do. Okay. So these parameters basically it depends on particle size distribution, inner porosity in particles. I am talking about permeability. I am talking about only these holes, that is what I am seeing, that is basically the thing. But do I know what is the basically the porosity inside the particle? That is your internal pores. So that will also control this. So what is the internal pore structure? Okay, because that will also basically hamper your basically the process. So inner porosity in particle, surface roughness. How do I quantify surface roughness and how do I quantify surface roughness for large tonnages of material? Then your wettability of the solids, even I do contact angle test, I take a few milligram of materials, but again the sampling issue becomes very, very important. How do I take that few milligram of particles for doing the wettability test? Very, very tedious problem to solve. Okay. So these parameters often overlap in a complex manner, that is I have a material in my nature made material, I may be having different combinations of this, then what will happen? Okay, I have done, I have focused my research work only on this basically the surface roughness. What will happen if my surface roughness changes by this, what do I have to do? But in actually naturally occurring mineral, I may have combination of all this at different degrees. So in that case, what will be my solutions? So I have to do with the real materials also, not always with the synthetic material. Synthetic material is good for understanding the phenomena of a particular dimension, but in nature made things we have some multi-dimensional problem. So how do I convert it into that? So these parameters often overlap in complex manner and therefore the optimum moisture content cannot be clearly defined. I have to do the test work. The optimum moisture content increases with increasing fineness. Of course, the more surface area means more moisture requirement. The following figure shows the influence of moisture content on a wet compressive strength and drop number in green pellets prepared from magnetite concentrates with varying fineness. Okay. So you see that these are basically the moisture percentages and this is the compressive strength of green pellets for a magnetite sample. These are the basically the graphs, but that is specific to that particular sample. Do not take it that this is a standard one. So you have to draw your this type of curves for your material if it is properly sampled. Okay. So although the very large influence of the moisture content on bollability is well recognized in practical bowling, the concept of optimum moisture content or material specific moisture content has not been defined in terms of theory. That is what I am saying. That is, we know what moisture does, but for a given material property, how much is the optimum moisture content? That theory is yet to be developed. That could be another research topic for you. Okay. Both the moisture content and the bentonite doses are well known to influence the green pellet growth rate. Increasing the moisture content increases the green pellet growth rate and increasing the bentonite doses has an opposite effect, because what it happens, it has got more of your say compactness of the material. I may have more strength, but the consequences may not be that advantageous. Okay. Now pelletizers, what are the various designs and what is the role of my pelletizer, pelletizing machine? That means the bowling stage is the most important part of the process and determines the strength, size, compactness and other pellet properties. So that means the heart of your system is the pellet making section, that is your green pelletization. But I have seen that people are giving more importance in the firing one. Okay. That is okay, that is also very important, but if your raw material, if your initial material is not having sufficient quality, then you cannot expect a better quality after firing. Okay. The operation is performed in rotating devices like drums, discs and cones. That means it could be a drum type of via pelletizer, it could be disc type of pelletizer, it could be even say cones also. The ball formation occurs because of surface tension forces of water at collisions between particles that we have discussed. Initially, small nuclei of pellet are formed on addition of water and the nuclei grow bigger. That is what I am saying, that is your layering mechanism, that is how the nuclei and the growth, that what are the kinetics. So, that is very, very important to know because it will control the residence time and the optimum doses of your binders. Okay. And then pellets, as they pick up loose grain particles during their travel through the drum, which is slightly tilted. Why it is tilted? Now, because of material transport thing. The angle of tilt determines the time of residence, pellet size and productivity. So, more the gradient, more the productivity, more faster you can get them. But does it provide you the quality of the pellet? What do we want? That is the strength and all. So, that angle is also very important. The size and shape of the drum should be such as to obtain the most favorable condition of motion and pressure. That is more of rolling as opposed to sliding action to ensure more effective collisions between the particles. Because it is like your ball mill, say it is rotated. So, whether I need more of particle collisions during your going up, that is your particle-particle collisions we need, or more when they are falling. Okay. If my centrifugal force, that is when you are rotating, a centrifugal force again coming, if my centrifugal force is beyond the critical limit, what will happen? All the material will be only rotating along with the material surface, that is your balling surface. Now, no ball will be formed. That is similar to your analogy to your grinding mill. How do I set my critical speed? So, there is a critical speed of my mill. So, what is that? Now, I will come to that. So, these are the different, basically the pictures of some of the pelletizers. This is called a disc pelletizer. Then there is a drum pelletizers like this. Okay. So, you can have drum type of thing. It is like you are having analogy to the kiln also. If you have seen a rotary kiln, but it is a smaller dimensions, because if you have a bigger dimension, then the residence time will be more, then your productivity will be less. It is slightly inclined, 1 to 2 degree of inclination is there, so that my particle movement is there. Okay. Then you look at that, what happens to a motion of particle in a disc pelletizer at various speeds. Okay. So, from the mechanical parameters affecting on the process, the variations of the movement of the pellets in the pelletizer disc with respect to revolution speed of the disc must be defined. What should be my critical speed and what happens? So, at a very low revolution, the movement of pellets is governed by gravitational force. When my RPM is very less, so the motion is governed by my gravitational force. And for high speeds, the movement is governed by the centrifugal force. If one of these forces becomes dominant, then either pellets formed have loose structure or formation is totally ceased. So, that means I have to have an optimum speed for that, because more centrifugal force means everything will be rotated, no formation of my pellet. More gravitational force means the structure will be very loose, because I have not given my binding materials to be get adhered to the surfaces of my materials. So, they will be loose. So, they will be, you will not have sufficient strength, especially if it is for the centrifugal force where all the particles are stuck to the side walls of the disc by means of adherence created by moisture. So, you see the different stages, because when it is moving at a very slow speed, it moves up to this and falls. So, it is mostly dominated by gravity. Okay. So, you have loose bonding. And in this case, if you increase it, then it will go up slightly and then comes back here. So, that means in the process, you are also testing that whether my pellets are having sufficient strength or not to withstand that. And then each moment you are picking up another fine particle to increase this, that is the growth it is occurring. Okay. So, there is a simple equation for that. If I do a force balance on that material, it is a simple that your balancing of the different forces. So, what will happen, that is, suppose this is my forces acting on an individual pellet during the pelletization process, the disc with radius r is shown here. Now, say suppose what is the revolutions per minute and critical speeds you can calculate here. Suppose the angle is denoted by beta, that is the angle of inclination of this. m is the basically the mass of the particle, and n is the normal force which can be for this exponent as a component it is mg cos beta, for this I can say it is n mu or the mg sin beta. So, what I will do? I will do force balance, it is a very simple one, that is mg sin beta plus mu mg cos beta is equal to m r omega square, okay. That is the w written, but it is basically omega square, which is the pi, the 2 pi r n, okay. So, where m is the mass of the individual plate, g is the gravitational acceleration, beta is the angle of the disc plane, mu is the coefficient of friction between the plate and the disc, that is very important to know, r is the radius of the disc, and w is the centrifugal acceleration radians per time square. So, however, when the centrifugal acceleration and gravitational forces are in equilibrium, then the normal force exerted by the pellet converges to 0, and the above equation simplifies that mg sin beta is equal to m r omega square, okay, like when they are in equilibrium. So, that is basically the critical limit, that is I cannot rotate it beyond that, because now it has reached the equilibrium, and if I rotate it more than that RPM, so my centrifugal force will start playing dominant role, then entire material will be only rotating. So, it is similar to ball mill, the mineral processing engineers, you know what is that I am talking. That is the critical revolutions per minute will be, that is n critical 42.3 divided by square root of d square root of sin alpha. So, based on this I can apply that what is my critical revolutions per minute, it is not alpha, it should be beta also, maybe some notation problem, it is the same thing as the angle of that. So, that is my critical limit. Now, how much of that critical limit at what rate? So, I have fixed the boundary conditions, the maximum limit. Now, I have to look at it in my basically the laboratory, that is basically determined by the basically material characteristics, your binder quality, your water quality and all this, and I have to say that whether my 60% of this critical speed is good enough, 70% is good enough, or 40% is good enough, that I cannot fix the value. But normally from 50% to 80% is the up to the critical limit, we normally use it for this pelletizers, okay. Now, optimum feed particle size, a typical grain size distribution of ore suitable for pelletizing is given in table below, but I have also given the sinter one. So, sinter one starts from 10 millimeter, you see that, and it can accept up to a size of your 60 micron. That is your sinter fines, okay. Some fines also we can accommodate here. But here I can start with 150 micron, but you see the more of concentration is on below 63 micron or 60 micron. So, that is why I have to grind it, but some tolerance has to be there, otherwise I cannot ensure 100% of passing minus 63 micron or 60 micron. That will add more cost to my process, and I may be generating more of your super fines, okay. So, that is the compromise you have. Now, for full capillary effect, the ore must be sufficiently fine grain, having about 95% to 100% of plus 0.1 millimeter and 60% to 90% of your minus 0.05 millimeter particles. That is the size restrictions, okay. Under optimum conditions, very compact grain pellets of sufficient strength are obtained for handling prior, during and after induriting. Induriting means is the firing section. So, I have to look at before that, during that and after that, what is happening to the pellet strength, okay. Such dense packing enables burning and hardening of pellets at temperatures lower than those required for sintering, especially for magnetite fines. So, magnetite fines are much easier to be pelletized than the hematitic ore, but magnetite I cannot charge it into blast furnace because the reactions are mostly endothermic. That is why we never charge magnetite into blast furnace, we have to charge hematite, because I need, if it is endothermic reaction, then my your coke rate, coke consumptions and other are very high, okay. So, that is basically a chemistry dominant phenomena. That is why we only talk about hematitic ores, not magnetite. The firing can be performed either in shaft furnaces or in continuous traveling grates. That is what I was telling you, that is the sintering and these furnaces and this firing mechanism could be same, but the dimensions could be different, okay. In the latter, drying, preheating, burning and cooling are all done in successive stages. So what is this? Basically, I'm talking, that is where the technology has come. That is earlier what I used to do. There were used to be all your separate stages, like your drying is separate, preheating is separate, burning is separate, and cooling is separate zones, like your different unit operations it used to be. But now the technological improvements are there, where you get one machine where you have basically compacted all the stages. That is, so nothing more than that, that you have got your all the basically processes combined into one machine. That is, you are having preheating, then drying, then burning, your burning, drying, cooling, everything in, done in one machine. So during firing, that means you have to heat it up. So what happens, your moisture goes out. So during firing, a critical stage is reached when the moisture is evaporated and yet the temperature attained is too low for any bond formation. So what happens? Now, if I have your green pellets, directly I am charging into a very high temperature. So suppose your firing temperature is 1200 to 1250 degrees centigrade, I am charging into that. So what will happen? My moisture will go out immediately, and my moisture was my main binder. So what will happen? Again, my particles will be fragmented. I will not be having. So I have to slowly evaporate that so that my bentonite comes into picture. Okay, that is for holding together. So the addition of even a small amount of bentonite or lime helps in maintaining some degree of cohesion among the grains during this period. So that is where your binder is required. That is a small amount of that, and after that, when you are heating, then the incipient fusion occurs, like your sintering, what I explained here. Then it takes care of its bonding. So in a nutshell, you see what we are doing. We have discussed about the bonding mechanism with the binder and the moisture, that is for having green pellet strength, so that I can retain the shape. I have that your pellet formation, and in the firing, basically I am using a different mechanism for giving the final strength to the basically pellet. Basically, when you are firing it, moisture will go out, but the binder will help them to hold them together for a while, and then by heating them at very high temperature, 1200, 1250 degrees centigrade, then my surfaces will be partially molten and they are basically bonded. So that is by, again, what we did it in the sintering process, the similar mechanism we are also using it in pelletization. That is, ultimate strength is coming from, again, your the bonding because of incipient fusion of my particle surfaces. So ultimate strength in your pellet is not coming from your binder or nor from water. It is coming from by this heating of this material at a high temperature. Okay. So appropriate firing pattern. If you look at, there was a sequence. I don't know why it is not coming. That animation was there. So for some reason it is not coming. So initially, when it enters into the firing cycle, so basically you heat it up to 300 or 340 degrees centigrade, and that is the updraft one, that is basically the drying zone. You are trying to evaporate your moisture very slowly. Okay, and this is where your bentonite plays a critical role. Okay, then you are downdraft drying. What you are trying to do, that when my moisture has gone out, so that means I will have more cavities. There may be some kind of looseness is there. So I am trying to suck them. So I have got a downdraft machine. That means I am passing air. I am trying to suck air through that so that the particles get much more closer. So that means whatever the looseness has occurred because of evaporation of my water, that I want to hold them together so that the particle surfaces, they get as closer as possible. And that is what is the problem with the coarser sizes pelletization. I can add more binder in the green pellet strength, I can have that, but what will happen? I will have less surface area. So during this firing one, I am having lesser amount of surface area. So my particle-particle incipient fusion, that bonding strength has to be more so that I can hold them together, because my individual particle mass will be more, but I am having lesser surface area. So that problem, coarser particle pelletization problem, will face more on the firing session than on the green pelletization. Yes, I can have binder and everything, but how do I basically handle this surface area related problems. Then that is the downdraft drying, then you are basically slowly rising the temperature, that is a heating cycle. Okay. So that is from your say around 400 to you take it up to your 1250 or 1300 degree centigrade, then leave it there for a firing for some time, and after that basically you are slowly cooling them, because what will happen if you know this, it is called a temperature effect, that is we call heat treatment cycle or any metallurgy processes. What happens even after this firing, if we cool them immediately, then because of thermal stresses the bonds will be again the pellets will be cracked, they will crack. So I have to basically cool them also in a particular cycle, and this entire design of this is basically that is the main design part of this machines. And do not buy your machine based on, again I am cautioning it, you look at this appropriateness of a machine with your material, with the type of binder you have used, whether it is applicable to your material or not, the otherwise you may get a different results. Okay. Now this is the appropriate firing pattern. Oh, okay, the animation has not come, so that is why it is showing again and again, there are 5 stages probably. So the animation has not come, it was basically trying to show different stages, something happened with the software related issues. Okay. Now this pellet bonds, depending upon the initial iron oxide, silica content and art of firing. Why you are saying art of firing, not technology of firing? Again there are so many ambiguities. Okay. That is basically the material related properties, heat conductivity, your thermodynamics and everything. So complicated that it has become more of a design specific, that is based on their experience and all this, that you are having a compromised solutions. That is why we call it art of firing, not the science of firing. It is very difficult to understand. The bonding forces for acid pellets are, that is for magnetite during firing at 1100 to 1250 degree centigrade, magnetite is oxidized to hematite, Fe2O3 gets converted, Fe3O4 gets converted into Fe2O3, that is the oxidation process, with an evolution of 55 kilocalorie per mole of heat, which ensures a uniform temperature distribution in the mass. In an excess of oxygen, the bonding is performed by bridging of magnetite grains through the hematite crystals formed. These are 2 fundamentals. The strengthening of the pellets occurs due to high surface mobility of the atoms during oxidation, recrystallization and crystal growth of hematite. That means at that temperature there is some kind of your phase changes inside the hematite matrix also. In a neutral atmosphere, the bond is formed through recrystallization and grain growth of magnetite. Okay. Now for in case of hematite, that is where our most interest lies, that is in the absence of any exothermic heat of oxidation, the bonding and strengthening effect is obtained by recrystallization process involving coalescence of ferric oxide particles in the grain. Okay. Now such a process needs higher temperature, usually 1300 to 1350 degree centigrade. That means it is more costly affair for hematite pelletization than for magnetite pelletization, because of this simple reason, exothermic and endothermic rate of oxidation, I am not saying reduction. So hence the firing time for hematite ore pellets is also higher, that means you need more time, because of the cooling is also has to be slow, so your residence time is more. The formation of bridges and hence pellet strength can be increased by fine grinding and also by intensification of crystallization with the use of pre-burnt or pre-reduced material. That is, how do I increase this crystallization process? Again that is a research aspect, that is how do I increase this, what helps in crystallization and this growth and bonding and all such and such. Slag bond, that is in cases where silica, lime etc. are present, slag formation above 1200 degree centigrade can also contribute as bonding agent. Such bonds give a glazed surface and retard the reduction rate, but they yield pellets stronger than sinters. So this is the reason now when during the pelletization process basically we talk about composite pre-reduced pellets, and not only the hematite iron ore, basically what research has been going on, I do not know whether it has been commercialized or not, that is during the pelletization process why do not you add some kind of fluxes like your limestone, because that will convert your silica in your iron ore in terms of your some slag, okay, because that can melt. If that melting point is around 1200 degrees centigrade, then this molten slag can act like a binder which can generate in situ strength of my pellet. And then we are also adding coke bridge, so that I can the degree of reducibility, because ultimately I have to reduce it by carbon, why don't you add it before that. And if it is already inside the matrix of my material, so my reaction kinetics or the reducibility will be faster. So this your lime or say fluxes, we are adding it in the pelletization process to improve my pellet strength, and we are adding also coke bridges to improve my reducibility of my material. So that is called the composite pre-reduced pellet. I am not aware that whether it has been commercialized, but the research is going on. I also did during my M.Tech level in 88 some work on that, that was my M.Tech thesis on composite pre-reduced pellets. Now this is called the fluxed pellets. Fluxed means when I am adding some kind of your fluxes, okay. It is possible to incorporate limestone in the pellet to obtain fluxed pellets. The stone needs to be ground to match ore fineness, which is a costly process. The first thing is that I can add, but then the surface area of this should match with the surface area of my iron ores. So that means it has to be ground to below 63 micron again. But when you are charging limestone in a blast furnace, you are charging at a lump material. So the additional cost of this grinding of this limestone and the benefit you get in the pelletization process for getting more strength, you have to do this comparison that which one is better. So you cannot directly say that okay, I will charge only flux pellets. You have to look at again the economics of the process, okay. Technical difficulties also arise during firing because of sticking of pellets. There is a question what Mr. Ram was asking, the what will be firing sequences for the flux pellets. That is what I am trying to answer here. So technical difficulties also arise during firing because of sticking of pellets, probably due to earlier softening caused by the formation of calcium silicate. But when you have your calcium silicate forms, they may soften and they may stick to my surfaces of my pelletizers, or maybe in the induration cycle or to the wall of this say actually the machine, they may get stuck. So I can have a hanging problem, I can have a scaffolding problem. So that means there could be a jamming or maybe reduction in my effective volume may be there. So I have to look at that. So the answer to your question is that it depends on at what temperature it melts and what is the softening point of that material. So your heating cycle depends on that material, okay. So then your such stickiness does not arise in acid pellets because low melting pyrolite does not form in the oxidizing atmosphere. So again you have to look at the slag chemistry and all this, how the slag forms, what type of slags it is, what is the basically the composition of that. In fluxed pellets, even if obtained from rich ores, an important role in bonding is played by glass because that formation of that or after melting. So main factors governing the strength of pellets are partial sintering of hematite or magnetite grains, some recrystallization of hematite and cementing of these two together by glass. In dolomitized pellets, that means where I have MgCSCO3, that is your MgO plus CSCO2 combination, that is your magnesium and carbon and then calcium oxides, that is called the dolomite. The in magnetite and calcium ferrite and on reduction forms higher melting solid solution, magnesio, oustite, so many things are there, you know, mechanisms. I do not want to bore you with all this. So flux pellets have the disadvantage of poor compressive strength, sensitiveness to weathering and decreased reducibility due to breakdown during reduction. That means this CSCO3, what happens, because if you are using it, okay, it is converting your silicate into calcium silicate, but it is getting dissociated into CaO plus CO2. The CO2 is start say trying to escape, find a escape route. So what will happen? It will create pressure into your internal walls and then it can create generate cracks into your pellets. So my pellet strength may be less. So that also you have to look at, that is how much is the strength, and then when it is falling from the top of a blast furnace, again it can be say fragmented. So I cannot use that. Then what is reducibility? You ask this question, Dr. Subramaniam, I am giving this answer. the again one day I showed you that how it works. That it is called basically basically the reaction mechanism, that how it happens. It is called shrinking core model in extractive metallurgy. What is this shrinking core? Now, first you are basically, when the gas is there, that is CO bulk gas there. So, first you have got a Fe-CO interface, then you get a Fe porous layer, then it has to come into molten stage, then only the next layer will be basically converted into Fe. So, ultimately what controls that is your diffusion of your gases through the basically the layers of this. So, if I have a very big particle, its rate of reduction will be slower because of the diffusion control process. So, your degree of metallization, that is your conversion of the entire metal oxide into a metal, will take more time than a very fine material. So, how much time it takes to convert the Fe2O3 into Fe, that is called the degree of reducibility. Okay. How do I measure it? It is simply by weight loss method I can look at. That is, I have got this hematite ore, I have added this much of carbon, and then if I am losing oxygen, that means there will be a weight loss of that. And I can simply put it, do this test into a muffle furnace or maybe in a TG apparatus, in a DT analyzer, we can do it and we can get to know this. And there are some standard tests in metallurgy also. Reactions involved in iron ore reductions are basically the reduction by CO, that is indirect reduction above 570 degree centigrade. Iron oxide is reduced by CO in 3 stages. These are the reactions. Below 570 degree centigrade, Fe3O4 is directly reduced to Fe bypassing the Oostite stage, that is the FeO stage, that is called the Oostite. This is not FeO, this is basically FeXO, X could be 0.95, it is not 1. So, that is a very unstable state. Okay. So, it gets converted. Okay. Reduction by carbon, these are the direct reductions, that is when I use the DR route, directly reduced iron, that is we can use the non-coking coal, because we are not say dropping that particle from a height, we are basically trying to mix them, because you have got a rotary kiln type of thing. It could be say actually few meters long, and then what is happening, your iron ore is coming from one direction and your coal is coming from another direction, and then your gas is formed and then you are basically reacting it. That is called a DR processes. So, these are basically the reactions there. Hematite is more reducible than magnetite, although the amount of oxygen to be removed per unit weight of iron is about 12% higher in the former. Although Fe2O3 is having more oxygen than Fe3O4, but in terms of reduction kinetics, Fe2O3 much easier to basically reduce because of this endothermic and exothermic reaction components. Formation of porous oostite from hematite easily accessible to reducer gas, whereas magnetite forms denser oostite during reduction. These are the reason. Tendency of hematite to break down and expose larger surface due to swelling. Pores in hematite are more elongated and the microporosity is larger. Magnetite has larger grain size and is more closely packed, a higher value of overall rate constant. So, that means the entirety of the things is that hematite is better reducible than magnetite, and there are some basically the metallurgical reasons that why you do not charge magnetite into blast furnace. The mineralogical composition of ores affects reducibility both physically and chemically, because it is a diffusion process. So, you know the internal pore structures, whether they are basically again the internal pores, whether they are open pores or they are interconnected pores. So, ultimately what is the porosity permeability of that within the particle, that also controls your basically the kinetics of that process. That is all what I wanted to discuss in this topic about pelletization. Thank you very much.